morning and welcome to Channel One Weekend. I trust you've had a lovely day. It is the 24th day of April 2020, and on Channel One Weekend, we have a comprehensive bulletin lined up for you. We shall be looking at Matters environment. There are areas across the country experiencing floods. Those are some of the issues that we shall be looking at. At the same time, we'll be looking at Matters security as well as COVID-19 disease. Now, on COVID-19, let's take a look at Matters in the country, whereby so far in the past 24 hours, 946 cases have been tested, as well as the confirmed cases in the country today in the past 24 hours were 16, bringing the total to 336. The number of recoveries tested in the past 24 hours were five, bringing the total to 94, while the total number of deaths so far recorded in the country stand at 14. Now, we shall be looking at that later on in our bulletin, but for now we take a look at the highlights.
Sixteen
more people test positive for COVID-19 as number of those infected by coronavirus in the country rises to 336. Change in traditions as Muslims mark the start of the holy month of Ramadan amid strict guidelines in the wake of coronavirus pandemic. And varied reactions as city residents adjust to the new normal amid uncertain future over the coronavirus.
Welcome to the broadcast. My name is Jackie Wambiru. Our sign language interpreter this evening is Lensa Odingo. Now let's kick off, whereby 16 more people have tested positive for coronavirus, bringing the total number of those infected with COVID-19 in the country to 336. What is more worrying is that all the 16 cases were picked up by surveillance teams and were living among communities. In the latest statistics, Nairobi recorded 11 positive cases, with Dandora accounting for the highest number at 5 cases. Meanwhile, 5 more people have recovered from the virus and discharged from hospital, bringing the total number of those who have recovered from the virus in the country to 94.
As the country continues to record more coronavirus cases, a new trend has emerged where positive cases are being recorded outside the quarantine facilities. For 2 days in a row, the highest number of confirmed cases was from among communities. On Thursday, 15 confirmed cases were from outside quarantine, while on Friday the number rose to 16.
16 persons have tested positive for COVID-19 disease. We therefore now have a total of 336 confirmed cases in the country. These 16 positive were picked out from among communities by our surveillance teams.
Nairobi County recording the highest number of new cases, standing at 11, with the cases distributed in Dandora, which has 5 cases, City Park and Parklands with 2 cases each, while Eastleigh and Pipeline recorded 1 case each. Mombasa County, which is slowly consolidating itself as a red zone, recorded 5 new cases distributed in Kiembeni, Sentikumi, Stadium, Msikiti Nuru and Mulaloni. The Ministry of Health saying that it had not received any formal request for a vaccine trial in Kenya from Oxford.
At this point, we do not have any information on this. And if this request does come to us, it will be subjected to the appropriate scrutiny before government responds to it.
This even as it said that Kenya was in talks with Uganda to aid in contact tracing of the 5 Kenyan truck drivers who tested positive in the neighboring country.
We are collaborating and sharing information, so that kind of information is available to us. As it is made available to us, we then can be able to begin the contact tracing as well. As we are ramping up our testing, we've been talking about targeted, expanded testing. We will also be probably doing the same thing in terms of testing truckers that may be coming into the country.
Out of the 946 samples tested over the last 24 hours, 532 were from Nairobi, 312 from Mombasa, 27 from Kilifi, 17 from Siaya, whereas Kwale, Mandera and Vihiga each had 15 samples tested. Nancy Okware, Channel One News.
Now moving on, as Muslims across the world start observing the holy month of Ramadan, millions of Muslims will mark the important period amidst the coronavirus pandemic. The pandemic altering traditions that have stood for ages with faithful now forced to live with a new normal. Supreme Council of Kenya Muslims Deputy Chair Sheikh Mudar Kitame now urging Muslim faithful to conduct their prayers at home and adhere to guidelines issued by the government to curb the spread of the deadly coronavirus disease.
The Muslim month of fasting is not just about staying away from food during the day, it is also about joining families. During the holy month of Ramadan, this is usually the sight across mosques. Usually, mosques host daily free meals after sunset, fundraising events and prayer gatherings for what is the most communal of celebrations. But this year has presented a new challenge with the outbreak of coronavirus. Rituals and routines have assumed a new normal. Most mosques in the capital of Nairobi remain quiet, an atmosphere that is new to those who usually worship here. The pandemic presenting a new normal where everyone is expected to observe social distancing rules, reducing the important celebrations into a largely virtual Ramadan. Supreme Council of Kenya Muslims Deputy Chair Sheikh Mudar Kitame says Ramadan sermons and teachings will be relayed through live radio shows and online streaming.
Mwezi wa kusherekea Qur'ani. Qur'ani madarasa ndio kitu muhimu. Na patikana misikitini. Kwa sababu wa misikiti, dharura imetokea namna hii, tuatumia vyombo. Vyombo vya habari, tuatumia FM station, tuatumia online. Ili watu wapate.
Kitame calling on faithful to observe guidelines as issued by the Ministry of Health. Deputy President William Ruto calling on Muslims to pray for the nation, adding that the government will continue to do its best in mitigating the adverse effects of the pandemic.
As you faithfully observe this important pillar of your faith, I urge each one of you to pray for our nation, Kenya, that God may have mercy upon us and that he may extend blessings to us and our neighbors for peace, unity, and prosperity.
The deputy president being just one of a host of national leaders to send messages of goodwill on the commencement of the holy month of Ramadan.
Ramadan hii, nasaha yangu ni kwamba Muislamu asivunjike moyo akawa hawezi kufanya ibada. Ibada ambayo, ama jambo ambalo amezuiwa ni kule kufanya ibada kwa pamoja. Lakini, unaweza kaswali tarawih yako nyumbani.
Maelekezo ambayo kwamba tumepatiwa na serikali tuyafuate, basi tusiwe ni wenye kudharau. Ikiwa tumehimizwa tuwe ni wenye kuvaa mask, basi tuhakikishe kwa usalama wetu tuwe ni wenye kuvaa. Ikiwa ni kusanitize mikono kila wakati, basi tuwe tuna sanitize. Ikiwa ni uoshaji wa mikono pia tufanye wingi. Na pia tusisahau kuwa responsibility kubwa haiko kwa serikali, bali iko kwa wewe Mkenya. 99% ni wewe mwenyewe utajisaidia, 1% ndio ya serikali.
The commencement date of Ramadan, the holiest Muslim month, is set by both lunar calculations and physical sightings, which determine when one month ends and another one begins.
Now, President Uhuru Kenyatta has urged Muslim faithful to pray for the country during the holy month of Ramadan in the wake of threats posed by the coronavirus. In his message of goodwill on the commencement of the holy month of Ramadan, the head of state urged Muslims to embrace guidelines issued by the government to contain the spread of coronavirus, saying this year's Ramadan will be commemorated differently in contrast with the past holy months.
The holy month of Ramadan kicks off tomorrow in the country. In the past, Ramadan is marked by fasting, communal worship and sharing of meals. However, this year, marking the holy month of Ramadan will be different amid the coronavirus pandemic. In his message on the commencement of the holy month of Ramadan, President Uhuru Kenyatta says the government is committed to mitigation efforts to combat COVID-19 disease. The head of state lauded health workers, security teams, researchers, emergency teams, and personnel who have been at the front line in fighting the crisis. President Kenyatta expressing optimism that Kenya will overcome the challenge, saying the nation will rebuild its businesses and economy. He pointed out that the holy month of Ramadan is an important period of reflection, fasting and prayer, urging all Kenyans of various faiths and denominations to join in reflection and prayer for Kenya during these challenging times. This even as he called on Kenyans to remember the less fortunate and vulnerable groups during this period in line with the spirit of Ramadan. Now, on a separate matter, the Kenya Medical Training College is vowing to use all resources at its disposal to reverse the current trend where people put on quarantine are breaking out with reckless abandon. The institution's management says security has been beefed up in its facilities spread across the country to counter plans by a few individuals keen to jeopardize the fight against COVID-19. The warning coming even as the Kenya Union of Post-Primary Education Teachers has ruled out any possibility of teachers resuming learning school next month.
Kenya Medical Training College CEO Professor Michael Kipto has termed the move by 25 persons to escape from quarantine as criminal, speaking during the launch of additional initiatives to curb the spread of the contagion. The chief executive noted that the act might prove costly and will jeopardize efforts to fight against COVID-19. For this reason, the institution is promising heightened surveillance to stop similar occurrences from happening.
Our facilities are safe, and we continue to ensure and thank the cabinet secretary working with the Interior Ministry for ensuring the security for our facilities is ensured.
The declaration coming at a time the Kenya Union of Post-Primary Education Teachers poured cold water on plans to have teachers go back to school next month. The union insists that the situation is still volatile given the number of COVID-19 active cases that are still being recorded.
We want to advise our good government. Even before we talk about school opening, we ask ourselves where we are in relation to the COVID-19. Are we in the rising? Are we in the flat zone? Are we coming down? We even don't know.
Kenyans are in the meantime demonstrating unity in the fight. At the Transport Ministry, high-ranking officials flagged off a consignment of antivirus equipment to be distributed to public transport operators. While receiving the package, the Federation of Public Transport directed the industry players to uphold and implement state directives on curbing coronavirus.
They play a very big role in terms of moving our people, in particular in the larger metropolis, you know, which is covered by Nairobi Metropolitan Area Authority, which covers about 5 counties.
We are also interested in getting the spray, so that our vehicles can be all the time be sprayed and fumigated.
Wiper Party leader Kalonzo Musyoka also chipped in with his support when he commissioned Food Basket Project, whose aim is to mobilize foodstuff, which in turn will be handed over to the COVID-19 Response Fund for distribution. Kalonzo says majority of Kenyans are going through difficult times, courtesy of the pandemic.
There are businesses that are staring at bankruptcy because they closed in small enterprises, small business people, closing down. We need to be able to help them. And this is a challenge that I think goes to the president, and I know that they are doing reallocations, as I said, in parliament.
Meanwhile, close to 10,000 residents of Jomvu in Mombasa County will benefit from 10.5 million shillings that will be injected to the NHIF kitty. The donation is aimed at assisting the needy to access healthcare services amid the pandemic.
Katika pesa hizi ambazo tumewapa, huduma hii itaweza kusaidia watu wetu. Katika kila mmoja ambaye ataweza kupata huduma hii, itaweza kumkava yeye na mke wake na watoto wake.
And Kenyans of goodwill have been asked to share the little they have during this moment of crisis. Speaking when he led Chuka University staff to donate masks, Professor Erastus Njoka noted that COVID-19 disease had affected almost every Kenyan, given that the country's economy has not been performing well. A similar gesture was shown by the Kirinyaga woman representative Wangoi Ngirishi, who donated foodstuff worth 4 million shillings to the elderly and orphans. She said the donation will benefit over 3,000 families in Media constituency, Kirinyaga County. And finally, in an effort to enhance and boost the fight against the COVID-19, Nyahururu Hospital has installed locally made automated sanitizing booths at its entrances locations. This is on top of watering points that are foot operated to dispense both soap and water for individuals visiting the health facility. Beatrice Gatonyangetich, Channel 1 News.
Well, thank you so much, Beatrice Gatonyangetich, for that report. Now, the global outbreak of COVID-19 has not only claimed lives and left others fighting to recover, but presented several other challenges like massive job losses and businesses closing down. The invisible enemy, that is COVID-19, has seen people follow guidelines akin to wartime laws to the letter. Safina Chingom has sought to find out how Kenyans are adjusting to the new normal.
It is a perfect view of the Nairobi metropolitan. What is imperfect, perhaps, is that the daily hustle and bustle of this ever-busy city has now been slowed down by the coronavirus outbreak. The streets are less populated, courtesy of the stay-home order. A few people are spotted moving up and down, perhaps playing catch-up. A majority seem deep in thought on how to sail through this murky season as they consume news of how the blade, that is COVID-19, continues to get sharper.
This disease is not a joke. If we continue to behave normally, this disease will treat us abnormally.
The world is now like a battleground. We are all fighting one enemy, coronavirus. Everyone is an important soldier in this war. We fight apart, but not alone. Putting on face masks, sanitizing, washing hands with soap and running water. Anything it will take to keep us all safe. Nothing is taken to chance.
Most priority area is prevention, and this comes through one, staying at home, as the government has directed. The second thing is using the hygiene measures that have been developed by the government and WHO.
What is no longer a secret, however, is how the global fight against COVID-19 has drastically changed the way of life. The economic paralysis has left many struggling to gather strength to fight coronavirus. Life is hard.
If this continues for more than it is now, I don't know whether we can survive it.
Tunasumbuka sana kwa sababu sahi makazi zimepotea, hakuna kibarua, kuna shida mtaa hakuna chakula, rent hakuna, kuna shida mingi.
Sasa tujui tutakuwa aje juu kiendelea hivi, hakuna chakula, kulipa nyumba ndio hiyo. Hakuna kuuza juu by the other squeeze customer kutubaye imekuwa ni kazi ngumu sana.
Many are now faced with the dilemma of whether to fight COVID-19 or fight for their own survival.
Itafika mahali hata sasa corona ndio itatumaliza, njaa ndio itatumaliza.
Sasa hizi tunaambiwa tuvae mask. Hizi mask tunaambiwa ni 3 hours, 6 hours or a day utupe. Watu tumekaa kwa nyumba hata chakula hatuna. Sasa ya mask tutatoa wapi?
Tunakufa moyo. Naona ni kama mimi nakufa the next minute. Hata naogopa kukutana na mwenzangu. Hata nikiwa na mwenzangu anatoka nje, naogopa aenda kufa.
The crisis forcing people to reassess where they place their trust. The nation coming to love simple chores that never seemed important.
Something may arise which you never expected. It's always good to have something that you have saved to cater for such a day.
Nimeona hii maisha ni maisha
fupi sana. Siku yoyote unaweza ondoka kwa hii duniani. Juu hii corona kuna wenye wamepoteza maisha yao.
Some, however, believe the government can do more to avert their agony.
Wangekuwa wameshatoa pesa ya kusaidia watu. Wale watu wote wako na huduma namba. Kila mtu apewe 10,000, 10,000, wakae kwa nyumba mwezi moja.
Watu wamekaa kwa manyumba wanangoja corona ishe. Haitaisha. Itaisha serikali ikichukua hatua.
But others peg their hope on God.
Tumulilie Mungu. Juu mimi naona ni kama pigo kwa Mungu amekasirika. Sasa ningeomba tu rais wetu kama anatusikiza, ajaribu kufungulia makanisa, watu tuombe, hata kama ni kukesha tutaamua.
But what cuts across is that we all need to bravely stand together to win the war.
Millions of people have been infected by coronavirus, which has also claimed thousands of lives. As we cling our hope on the numbers of those who have recovered from this global pandemic, everyone has now been cornered in their small corner of the world. Questions linger. How long will this take? What are we dealing with exactly? I know it's trying times, but we all have to do our part to be able to win this war. Stay safe. For Channel One News, I'm Safin Acheng Ouma.
Well, thank you so much, Safin Acheng Ouma, for those mixed reactions of Kenyans adapting to the new normal. Now we take a short break. We'll be right back.
Virusi vya corona vinazidi kuenea haraka kote ulimwenguni. Na kwa sasa, hakuna dawa au chanjo ya kuzuia. Husambaa wakati vijitone kutoka kwa mtu aliyeambukizwa vinaporuka akiongea, kukohoa au kupiga chafya. Vijitone hivi hutua kwenye sehemu ambazo mikono hushika na huwezi kuviona. Lakini hata kama huvioni, haimaanishi kuwa hakuna. Na unaweza kuambukizwa unapogusa uso wako, pua, mdomo au macho. Ili kusaidia kuzuia kuenea kwa virusi hivi, sote tuahitajika kufanya mambo matano. Moja, fuata hatua hizi: kuosha mikono yako mara kwa mara na sabuni na maji kwa angalau sekunde 40. Mbili, funika mdomo wako na kiwiko wakati wote unapokohoa au kupiga chafya. Tatu, usishike uso wako. Nne, epuka sehemu zenye watu wengi. Weka umbali salama baina yako na wenzako. Tano, kaa nyumbani ukiweza, hasa ikiwa una dalili zozote za ugonjwa. Kwa maelezo zaidi, tembelea www.who.int.
Welcome.
Ah, hello, madam.
I need to get to Elysium.
Whoever has this has the power to override their whole system.
Hey, bring down the bone saw!
This ain't gonna kill me.
You can save everyone.
We're gonna break into the most heavily guarded place in the universe.
Oh yeah. They will hunt you to the edge of the earth for this.
This weekend on KBC Channel 1.
Salma nikuulize.
Naam.
Wamkumbuka Mzee Konde?
Mzee Konde wa hii shamba tunaoishi hapa. Yule aliyokufa?
Ehe. Hassan alikuwa ofisini juzi. Asema ajua siri yote kuhusu hii shamba. Sasa ni maneno gani Hassan anayojua?
Baba yuko wapi?
Baba alikuwa aje, lakini ampatikana na dharura kidogo.
Mama, mimi nilijua tu. Nilijua istosha nimemuacha kwenye ndoto.
Mimi wazo langu lilikuwa kwa akae kule huko miezi sita hata mwaka mpaka akili yake atakapokuwa sawa.
Kwani hiyo ndio suluhisho mama?
Una lazima nifanye kazi katika hiyo nyumba mama. Wajua vizuri sana hao ndio wamefanya kwamba shamba letu limepotea.
Welcome back. It was a ceremony of a kind in Migori County as a section of Kuria elders performed rituals in an apparent attempt to cast away the spells of coronavirus. The elders poured libation, offered sacrifice of traditional medicine to appease their gods to send away the virus that continues to devastate the globe, even as they urged for strict adherence to guidelines issued by the government to further curb the spread of coronavirus.
These are the elders from the Kuria community, drawn from Bugumbi clan, who are gathered for a special ceremony. The elders opting to employ an ancient method to deal with natural calamities. They have once again resorted to the old ways so as to cast away the spells of the global coronavirus pandemic. The Kuria community that spreads to neighboring country of Tanzania sees the pandemic as a big threat, with positive cases on the rise.
Magonjwa ilikuwa inakuja hapa mengi tangu zamani, lakini hiyo turirudisha ikaenda nyuma. Sasa vile tunarudisha na hii, tunaomba Mungu wetu kwenye mlima wetu hii ya Renjo Karebwiri kuwa urudisha hii kitu mkuu wetu.
The billowing smoke is that of burnt traditional medicine after pouring libation and other sacrifices to appease the gods. Their chair, Bohoko Mahiri, says despite strong ties to the gods, as a community, they will abide by the guidelines issued by the Ministry of Health.
Tuwaseona kuchu hapa, tunawuchi na miti, mbali asa kukisimamisha, iruti mahali na toka.
Na vile wameasha hizo moshi yao lioni lipandisha juu kabisa, ikionesha kwamba Mungu ameitikia mwito wao, kwa hivyo hii kitu itamalizika na itaisha. Kwa hivyo pia tuko na mwito wa rais wetu, vile amesema, tukiwakitoka hapa kila mtu ataingia mahali ameingia kwa nyumba yake. Wana tutasaidiana na rais, vile mwito wa rais tuwausikie vizuri sana. Kwa hivyo sisi tuko pamoja na...
That this is not the beginning of not... adhering to the government and the Ministry of Health directives. We are telling our people that the directives of the Ministry of Health must be followed to the latter, as we also join the war from this perspective.
They believe the sacrifice was accepted and very soon the pandemic will be a thing of the past. For Channel One News, I'm Sarafina Robi.
Now moving on, with the confirmed cases of the coronavirus in the country rising each day, local artists are speaking out to keep their fans informed while urging them to stay home in order to help reduce the risk of transmission. Now the latest being three local musicians who have teamed up to compose a song to sensitize residents of Samburu.
The coronavirus pandemic continues to disrupt normal businesses across the globe, and the situation in the country has not been spared either. To sensitize members of the public on the dangers posed by the disease, local artists have launched various initiatives to get the message home. In Samburu, three artists have composed a song to uplift the spirits of its locals. Sarung Ginero, Mr. DJ Jaja and Soja Boy 254 say that they reached a decision to do a song as a way to disseminate information on how to keep the contagion at bay.
Tumeamua kama wasanii wa Samburu tutumie the same way venye wanasikiza ngoma zetu, pia tutumie the same way kutoa wimbo ya corona, kuelimisha kwamba corona ni mbaya, ni ugonjwa ambayo inaambukizana, watu wanaambukizana. Kuna wasi wa boda boda kama mnacheki hapa, at least wamedunga hizo staff hizi mask pia, So tulikuwa tuna create awareness tu ya corona. Awareness tunaambia wase wa mama pale, mtu akuja kununua mboga hapo una make sure amenawa mikono.
And this initiative is receiving commendation from the locals.
Nashukuru wasanii wetu ambao wamekuja leo hapa kwa boda boda kutufunza jinsi ya kujikinga na corona.
Yusuf Farah, Channel One News.
And still on COVID-19, the coronavirus pandemic will see the world Muslim population numbering about 2 billion people observe the holy month of Ramadan differently, refraining from social gatherings to break fast and abandoning communal prayers. The development coming as the number of those infected by COVID-19 across the globe rose to over 2.7 million people, with at least 757,000 people having recovered from the illness, with at least 192 fatalities.
The coronavirus pandemic has resulted in drastic changes across the world, with many facing unemployment, travel plans have been cancelled, and public places remaining empty as some work from home, practicing social distancing and self-isolating. As most countries enforced restriction on movement to curb the spread of the novel virus, religious groups have adjusted to new realities, including Muslims during the holy month of Ramadan. At least 3,332 new coronavirus deaths were reported in the United States in a 24-hour period, one of the deadliest days since the outbreak began. The total death toll in the country has surged past 50,000 amid over 886,000 cases. Testing of an experimental COVID-19 vaccine began on healthy volunteers at the University of Oxford in Britain, the latest in a cluster of early-stage studies in search of protection against coronavirus. Spain has reported 367 new deaths from coronavirus, the lowest daily toll in over a month. A total of 22,524 people have died from COVID-19 in Spain, against cases total of 219,764. Iran's death toll from the new coronavirus has risen by 93 to reach a total of 5,574. The total number of people diagnosed with the disease is 88,194, of whom 3,121 are in critical condition. Africa registered a 43% jump in reported COVID-19 cases over the last week, highlighting a warning from the World Health Organization that the continent of 1.3 billion could become the next epicenter of the global outbreak. WHO also warned that the number of deaths caused by malaria in sub-Saharan Africa could double to 769,000 as efforts to tackle the disease faced disruptions by the coronavirus pandemic. South African's President Cyril Ramaphosa says his government will allow a partial reopening of the economy on May 1st, with travel restrictions eased and some industries allowed to operate under a five-level risk system. Egypt, on the other hand, will keep a nighttime curfew for the holy Muslim month of Ramadan to curb the coronavirus spread, but will allow one extra hour of movement. More than 192,000 people have succumbed to the pandemic, including 50,000 in the U.S., with 2.7 million infected globally, out of whom almost 757,000 have recovered. For Channel One News, I am Emily K. Bade.
COVID-19 is a respiratory illness, and the primary transmission route is through person-to-person contact and through direct contact with droplets generated when an infected person coughs or sneezes, according to the World Health Organization. But can the virus be transmitted via food or through food packaging?
Everything to prevent COVID-19 with respect to food safety will oscillate around food hygiene and use of PPEs. Food hygiene here, it is very clear that you have to maintain and wash it. And with respect to food preparation, what matters here is the frequency. Is the frequency at which you are washing your hands. I'm in bakery, and we are churning out thousands of loaves for you to use once you stay at home. And therefore, between the preparation, the frequency of hand washing becomes very key. In your house, Key number one, make it clean. Make it clean. Because when you make it clean, it means your services are already clean, your services are already sanitized, and there is good disposal of all the waste. So you're making the environment as clean as possible. The second key is that you separate both cooked and the raw. The reason why you are separating both is because, remember what you bought from the market, like the fruits and vegetables. We want you to wash. We want you to keep aside. If you already have cooked food, give it aside. Separate. Never mix both.
Now let's shift gears from health matters to environmental matters, where those living in the coastal region have been put on high alert over imminent floods that could hit parts of the coastal region following heavy rains pounding parts of the country. Sections of Kilifi, Kwale, Taita Taveta and Tana River counties have been red flagged after reports indicated that the water levels in River Sabaki and River Tana had risen significantly.
Mpaka kufikia mto ni takriban zaidi ya kilomita mbili, na yale mashamba yote ambayo yako katika area hii ni yote ni kama yameweza kuzama kufikia saa hii.
Over 500 acres of farms were submerged in parts of Madogo after River Tana burst its banks following heavy rains that continue to pound most parts of the country. Farmers calling on the government to intervene to cushion them from losses, saying they had expected high yields and returns this season.
Zile dams ambazo ziko upande ule wa juu ambazo zinatumika kuweza kuweka maji zote sasa zimeweza kufurika mapema haya. Kwa hivyo hiyo maji yote tuyatarazamie upande huu wetu. Kwa hivyo na vile ilivyo, nafikiri yale mafuriko ambayo tutapatana nayo humu kwa wakati huu inaweza ikakuwa mbaya zaidi kulishinda yale ambayo tushawahi kuzishuhudia.
Musa Warido from Legbana says about 200 acres of his farm have been submerged and he now has nothing to fend for his family. In the coast region, the Kenya Red Cross has issued an alert on imminent floods in areas of Kilifi, Kwale, Taita Taveta and Tana River counties due to the sustained rainfall currently pounding the country. Already, Governor Amason Kingi has issued an alert and directed people living along riverbanks to move to higher grounds to avoid loss of lives.
So tumepata ujumbe kwamba mafuriko yameanza katika sehemu ya miinuko ya Kenya, na kawaida mafuriko yakianza katika sehemu ile, bila shaka tunajua wazi kwamba mto Sabaki lazima utafurika, na wakati mwingi unaleta uharibifu mkubwa. Na kwa sababu tumepata habari hizi mapema, tayari ujumbe tumepeleka kule mashinani sehemu ya Sabaki kwamba watu wote ambao wanaishi katika sehemu ya tambarare ya mto Sabaki waondoke na waende katika sehemu za miinuko.
Meanwhile, motorists plying the Narok Mai Mahiu route have been advised to seek alternative routes. This after flood waters severely damaged the section approaching CFA Bridge. The Kenya National Highways Authority has embarked on urgent restoration works.
We actually need a dual carriageway in that road to Suswa. Na hapa all the way kupita Narok, the same way tuko na ile Thika Road. This is what we need here. Very important road. We need a dual carriageway. And of course, the bridges here need to be expanded. Just to provide alternatives.
Caroline Kamau reporting for Channel One News.
Now, away from that, six illegal firearms have been surrendered to authorities in Transmara West Sub-County just hours before the lapse of an ultimatum issued by the government on Wednesday. The illegal firearms were surrendered in Kararo Village, an area that has witnessed bloody confrontations between two rival clans.
A meeting between Narok County Commissioner Samuel Kimiti, political leaders drawn from Narok County, and elders from Syria and Uasin Gishu clans that required rival groups to surrender illegal arms within 2 days have started bearing fruits after one of the warring clans surrendered six illegal firearms.
Wakati tumepokea hizo silaha na tumepokea hizo risasi, na pia ningesema kwamba tumewaambia ile jamii mingine pia ambayo ilikuwa nazozana na Syria ya Uasin Gishu, tumebakisha siku tatu tu watoe hizo silaha wako nazo.
Those surrendered included an M16, 1G3 rifle, 4 AK-47 and 16 rounds of ammunition.
Ile silaha ambayo imetumika kwa hii vita sio bunduki peke yake. Kuna pia ile mshale ambazo zimetumika kuumiza watu wengi waliumia kutokana na mambo na mara ya kwanza vita ilikuwa mambo ya mshale tu. Tungependa hizo mshale zote pia wale wako nazo wazirudishe kwa chief. Tupange siku alafu tuzichome zote.
Deputy County Commissioner Mohamed Hassan Nur, who received the firearms, urged the rival groups to comply with the government directive and surrender all illegal firearms in their possession.
Kwa wakati huu tutaomba regional commissioner baada ya silaha zote kurudi. Ikirudi sasa tutakuwa na nguvu ya kumwambia bwana Natembea sasa hii watu wamerudisha silaha, wamekubali amani na tungependa hiyo masaa ifanywe kama Wakenya wengine ile saa moja.
Kwa unyenyekevu utupunguzie hizi masaa ili tuweze kuwa kama Wakenya wengine saa moja. Manake tunajua kwamba Kenya ilikufanya ukaweka hiyo saa kumi ni uchungu kwa sababu damu imemwagika, mali imeharibika, lakini tumekubali amani na tumeomba msamaha kama jamii kusema kwamba sisi tumekubali amani na ndio maana tumesalimu amri, tumepeana silaha kwa serikali ambazo wanastahili kuwa nazo.
Tuliumia sana kwa sababu ya hii vita na nashukuru serikali ambayo walitutembelea na kutupa amani, wakakaa kutuchunga, tunakunywa chai pamoja.
The move is aimed at finding a lasting solution to the perennial conflict that has marred the region, witnessing loss of lives and property. Reporting for Channel One News, I'm Gladys Mungai.
A number of people living in a disputed land in Nairobi's Roy Estate are pleading with the government to reconsider its notice to evacuate them. Over 100 families that have been affected by the ongoing demolitions as the state moved in to reclaim the over 3,000 acre land that was originally set aside for sewerage purposes argued for more time to move out, especially as the country fights the coronavirus pandemic. The families further want the state to consider their plight, given that they have already suffered heavy losses occasioned by the purchase of plots within the disputed piece of land. They claim that an eviction at this moment in time will almost destroy their livelihoods.
Tulikuja tukakuta ni ya East Head Company. Na sasa tumekuja tukaambiwa ati sijui chaba ni ya Nairobi Water and Sewerage. Sasa tunashindwa ni kitu gani inaendelea pale pale, kwa sababu sisi hata tukienda kufanya search tuliona hiyo kampuni ndiye imemiliki na ndiye inalipia late hii chaba. Sasa tunashindwa tuelekee wapi.
Nimekaa hapa zaidi ya miaka 5. Tumechenga shamba tuliuziwa na certificate. Tukaambiwa certificate itatangulia baadaye tuongoja title. Tumekaa hapa, tumelelea watoto hapa. Sisi hakuna kitu tumepewa kama notes ya kuonyesha tunafaa kuhama hapa.
Kwa hii shamba like me, I'm in my sixth year. I don't know where to go. Niko na watoto wengine karibu 4, sijui mahali nitaenda. Sasa nataka tu kuuliza, haki tu itendeke, wahurumia watoto hata wasipotuhurumia sisi. Tujue venye kulienda, tukafika hapa na nikununua, tuko na certificates, we don't know where to go.
Now on to environmental matters. With the onset of the long rain season, which is predicted to continue over the next 3 months, the Kenya Forest Service has partnered with stakeholders to reforest depleted water towers in an exercise meant to increase the country's forest cover. Now KFS board chair Peter Kenya says Kenyans must embrace ongoing efforts aimed at restoring the country's forest cover if Kenya is to avert adverse effects associated with environmental degradation.
Stripped bare of trees lays the Marani Forest, located within the magnificent Mount Kenya Forest, now colonized by wild shrubs and underground vegetation.
While we are at the Marania Forest, that is approximately 7,250 hectares and is part of the larger Mount Kenya Forest. Now, during the dry season, the place experiences wildfires that are either caused by the harsh climatic conditions or activities from the communities that live adjacent to the forest. Now today the Community Forest Association, in partnership with relevant forest stakeholders, have partnered in an initiative to restore the native forest and improve lost biodiversity.
Apart from the wildfires caused by extremely harsh conditions, dogmas that lighting a fire could bring rain by members of the community living around the forest and forest activities such as beekeeping have acted to compromise efforts aimed at conserving the forest.
One of the biggest problems is fire breaks. So we are talking to Mount Kenya Trust and even as Kenya Forest Service, we are working towards now establishing proper fire breaks. There's also belief in some areas around here in Meru that if you start a fire, then you will get rains.
The Kenya Forest Service, in conjunction with the Mount Kenya Trust and the Community Forest Association, now embarking on an initiative to restoring the lost beauty of the native Marani forest by planting 9,000 seedlings.
Today we have planted about 9,000, so we can say that within from the other Saturday when we started, we've done about 20,000 seedlings.
Tuko na team ambao wanafanya patrol kwa farasi, wanatembea kwa msitu wakiona jambo lolote baya ama uharibifu wote, wanashirikiana na Kenya Forest Service na Kenya Wildlife Service kuweza kufuata hao wahalifu ndio waweze kuchukuliwa tu.
The initiative has integrated the local community in conservation efforts, saying the concept remains the best yet at ensuring their efforts are sustained. This is Rhoda Karimi.
Juwezi panda mti ikiwa kwa karatasi. Natoa mti pole pole. Usimwage hii mchanga. Unapanda mti pole pole. Naongeza mchanga.
The COVID-19 pandemic that continues to devastate the globe means that only a small number of the local community will participate in the exercise on this day.
Normally you'd have school children here planting with us or communities. Now, maximum 45 people.
And with the moratorium against cutting of trees in place, several arrests have been made in the area to deter degradation of the critical forests.
With the forest cover estimated to be about 7.2%, the government hopes to achieve a 10% forest cover by 2022. Reporting for Channel One News from Marania Forest in Mount Kenya, I'm Sarafina Robi.
Now, that report on the initiative aimed at increasing the country's forest cover brings us to a second break here on Channel One Weekend. Don't go too far. We'll be right back.
People who choose to read their Bible daily, they become wiser and they become stronger than the people who don't read their Bibles. So when you choose hard, difficult things, you become a natural leader. He brings us to church to introduce to us another higher level of relationship that is called a faith relationship. You are also a solution to somebody else's problem. You cannot be the only problem all the time.
Join Pastor Jimmy Masharia on The Master's Touch this Sunday from 8 a.m. on KBC Channel 1.
This weekend on KBC Channel 1.
I'd be very careful the way you address me, given that I literally have your life in my palm.
People lose hands and palms every day.
Be careful you don't get yourself in that list.
People, why can't you give Solomon a chance to speak out? You talk like angry monkeys. And you, when are you ever going to learn to listen?
Okay, if you know you took my juice, it's not that expensive, it's only 10 bucks.
Why is this Angela face laughing?
Don't mind her, eh? Tell us the good news, Murume, eh? You know some of us need something to cheer us up.
Classmates, every Saturday on KBC.
Eternal Father, I offer you the body and the blood.
And now to the business world. The government has deployed widespread use of technology to deal with the coronavirus pandemic. ICT Cabinet Secretary Joe Mucheru has told the Senate Ad Hoc Committee on COVID-19 that the measures include use of contact tracing applications, upscaling cashless transactions, as well as launching to improve internet connection in remote areas of the country. Here is O'Brien Kimani with the details.
As the coronavirus disease continues to shatter the global economy, governments have imposed sweeping measures such as curfews, prohibition of mass gatherings, mandatory quarantines, closure of learning institutions, as well as discouraging cash transactions. Some of these measures have boosted the use of digital technologies. In Kenya, where mobile money reach is more than 90%, cashless transactions have become the norm. The government, through the Kenya Institutes of Curriculum Development, has also rolled out online classes for students. The government plans to roll out telemedicine infrastructure to all major public hospitals. CS Mucheru has further told the committee that the government has released 13 billion shillings to be used to settle pending bills to suppliers. During the virtual meeting, Broadcasting Principal Secretary Esther Koimet also told the committee that a turnaround white paper for the Kenya Broadcasting Corporation has already been finalized and ready for presentation to the National Treasury. The virtual meeting brought together players from the ICT industry, such as courier service providers, broadcasters, performing artists, among others. An ICT advisory committee has already been formed by the ICT Ministry to advise the government on how to upscale ICT services to deal with the pandemic.
Now, on a separate matter, Egypt's leading private sector lender, Commercial International Bank, has completed the acquisition of a 51% majority stake in Mayfair Bank Limited, effective 1st of May 2020. According to the Central Bank of Kenya, Commercial International Bank entry in the country through the transaction is expected to diversify and strengthen the resilience of the banking sector, with services targeting SMEs, institutions and corporate sector.
The announcement by Central Bank follows CBK's approval on 7th April 2020 under Section 13, Cap 4 of the Banking Act and approval by the Cabinet Secretary for the National Treasury and Planning on April 8th, pursuant to Section 9 of the Banking Act. CIB's business model focuses on individuals, small and medium enterprise institutions and corporates. The acquisition of a majority stake in Mayfair Bank Limited will anchor CIB's expansion into the East African region. Its entry will also strengthen the trade and investment ties between Kenya and Egypt. CIB was licensed by the Central Bank of Egypt on August 13, 1975, and is currently the leading private sector bank in Egypt with a total asset base of 2.4 trillion shillings. CIB is listed on the Egyptian Stock Exchange, London Stock Exchange, and trades over the counter on the New York Stock Exchange. CIB has representative offices in the United Arab Emirates and Ethiopia. On the other hand, Mayfair Bank Limited was licensed in June 2017 and commenced operations in August 2017 and has 5 branches in Nairobi, Eldoret, and Mombasa. It targets high net worth individuals and the corporate market segment. It is categorized as a small bank with a market share of 0.17% as at February 2020. Under the deal, CIB will provide the Mayfair Bank Limited with the requisite skills, resources and infrastructure to scale up its business. The acquisition is expected to diversify and strengthen the resilience of the Kenyan banking sector. Regina Manyara-Gitao reporting for Channel One Business.
Established manufacturers and Jerkali artisans have been urged to collaborate in developing quality products to meet local needs in the wake of coronavirus pandemic. Industrialization, Trade and Enterprise Development Cabinet Secretary Betty Miner says this will be key in boosting capacity of the Jerkali industry in producing hospital beds, ventilators, among other equipments.
According to the Kenya National Federation of Jerkali Associations, the country has over 17.5 million people employed in micro, small and medium enterprises. However, even before the coronavirus pandemic, most of the Jerkali artisans were unable to get credit from banks and to keep their businesses afloat. This now coupled with a depressed economy means money is not flowing, pointing to a possible total crumble in the industry. To this end, the government is offering advice for a possible lifeline.
Then I'm certain, looking at this, the way this is made, I hope this is also a partnership you can reach with our Jerkali sector.
Absolutely.
To cut and, you know, especially for the large assembly, I hope that there's a partnership with the guys in the Jerkali sector to be able to make these plates.
Speaking during the presentation of a bridge mechanical ventilator by Toyota Kenya, CS for Industrialization Betty Miner further said individual Jerkali artisans were also welcome to showcase their inventions to the ministry when not partnering with corporates, adding that there are no restrictions.
I think it's important that these people also come out and reach out to the ministry and our agencies and our staff. We have staff all over the country, industrial development officers. So I think it's important that they reach out and let us know what it is that they have innovated and the support they require.
The COVID-19 pandemic has seen more corporates and learning institutions emerge with innovation, heeding the government's call for locally made solutions.
It is critical that we see the full range of possibilities. So this is something that can be easily deployed around the country, can be deployed in many hospitals, can be deployed in many dispensaries, and can support to keep people alive should they get to be to the place where their lungs require this help. So I really am excited.
It's a manual system, like we said, it's used to actually pump the air into the lungs. We can regulate the breaths that is actually required using the mechanism. And more so, it can use battery as well as electricity. Battery using the smaller batteries, like even a motorcycle battery, to a larger battery.
Toyota Kenya's mechanical bridge ventilator was made from the engine parts of the Toyota Land Cruiser to aid COVID-19 patients with respiratory difficulties.
You might be there wondering that the machines being showcased as prototypes at the Ministry of Industrialization has just been made by corporates, but as an individual, you too can also showcase your equipment to the government to fight this common cause. Alan Aoko reporting with Channel One Business in Nairobi.
And now in the sports arena, local betting firm MBET has started discussions with the government aimed at supporting local sport federations during the coronavirus crisis. Thousands of people have lost their lives from the virus worldwide, with the US and Italy being the most affected countries.
Local betting firm MBET, which started its operations in the country,